In this video, we are going to install our own Docker registry on our k3s cluster. This will provide storage for custom Docker images that we're going to build. Later, we'll have k3s deploy pods based on these custom images. To follow along with this video, you will need a running k3s cluster. You'll also need a working cert manager install on the cluster with a Let's Encrypt issuer set up on it. If you don't have that set up, check out the previous videos in this playlist to learn how to do that. Let's run through a quick set of requirements for our registry. We want the registry to be a private registry for our own images. We want the registry to be internet accessible so we can push to it from anywhere, not just in the cluster. As an internet accessible registry, we want to make sure it is secured with TLS. We'll have traffic automatically procure a TLS certificate for us. And we want to configure basic auth on it so that it requires a username and password to access. First, we'll create our basic auth credentials file. You will need the HT password utility for this. On Ubuntu-based systems, this utility is packaged in the Apache 2 utils package. You can install that package with a standard app install command. If you're not using Ubuntu, you can search your package manager for the utility, or you can search the web for HT password generator to find online generators. I can't vouch for the security of those, but they are available if you can't find the tool or you don't want to install it. Once the tool is installed, we can invoke it, giving it the name of the output file, in this case HT password, and a username. In this case, we'll use registry as our username. It prompts us for the password, and we just enter it and confirm it. This creates the file HT password on our local file system. And we need to store this file in Kubernetes so that our Docker registry can access it. We'll do that by adding it as a Kubernetes secret. To do that, we use kubectl to create a secret named Docker registry HT password. From the local HT password file. To confirm that worked, we can run kubectl describe on it. There we go, that looks good. Now we're ready to create the registry YAML configuration file. I'll use the technique I normally use of copying the stock configurations from Kubernetes documentation and then modifying them. You can do that as well, but if you don't want to edit these files yourself, as always, a link to the files that I use in the video is provided in the video description. We'll create a file called registry.yaml and paste in the stock deployment config. We'll make up a name, Docker Registry. Use the same name for the app. And for both the labels, and the container name. As for the image, the Docker Hub name for a Docker registry is just registry. Registry image supports ARM targets automatically, so we don't have to specify that here. When we pull the image from our Pi, it will detect the ARM architecture and pull down the correct one automatically. And the container port for Docker is 5000. That's enough to get a registry pod running, but we need to configure some storage for our images, and we need to tell Docker about our preferred authentication mechanism. First, the storage. We'll tell Kubernetes to create a volume named storage. We'll set that storage type to empty dir for now. Let's make a note to make this more permanent storage later. But just a quick note about empty dir. This kind of volume is created when the pod is created on a node. It uses the storage mechanism of the node. So in this case, that'll be the SD card on our Pi. Also, it only exists as long as the pod is running on that node. It will survive crashes of the pod, but any pod deletes or switches to another node will cause the storage to be deleted. This is obviously not ideal, but we haven't yet learned about better Kubernetes storage options. We will soon though. Now we need to mount that into the container. We'll use volume mounts for that. We'll give it a name of storage and a mount path of /var/lib/registry. This is where the Docker image looks to store its data by default. That takes care of storage. Now let's mount that credential secret that we created earlier. we'll create another volume, call it HT password, and set its type to secret, with a secret name matching the secret that we created earlier, docker-registry-ht password. Add another section to volume mounts. We want to mount the HT password volume at a mount path of, let's say, /auth. We'll add a little extra protection here and say that this is a read-only mount. That gets the file into the container, but now we have to tell the registry about it. Now the registry image is set up to allow you to configure it with environment variables. Fortunately, Kubernetes makes that easy. Let's create another section in the container called env. We'll add a variable named registry_auth, give it a value of HT password. This tells the registry that we're using HT password based basic authentication. Add another variable, registry_auth_HT password_realm. Give that a value of Docker registry. This is the basic auth realm name that shows up in a browser when you're prompted for username password. Also add registry_auth_HT password_path. With a value of /auth/password. This is the path to the credentials file in our container. And we'll add a non-related extra variable while we're here of registry_storage_delete_enabled. Set that to true. Registry doesn't allow delete by default because images going away in public registries are generally bad things to do. However, we have a private registry, so we may want to do that in the future, so we'll take care of that. I think that does it for configuring the pod. So let's have a quick recap. We've set up a volume for storage, set up a volume for authentication, pointing to a secret with our username and password in it, and we told the registry to use that. So that's the pod. Now we need to set up the service to allow access to it. Again, we'll copy the base configuration from the documentation and paste it into our file. We'll set the name to docker-registry-service. The app is docker-registry. Now this has to match the app that we set above. Protocol is still TCP. Port is 5000. And we don't need target port. Service is configured. Now we want to set up the ingress record. Our ingress record differs a good bit from the stock ingress config. So let's cheat a little and use the ingress record that we used in the my site example from the cert manager video. Now that I'm looking at this ingress, I see a problem that's going to bite us now that we are setting up something on a different hostname. In our rules section, we don't have a hostname set, so it's going to gobble up all traffic coming into any host. If you don't have the sample deployed from the previous videos, you don't have to worry about this, but if you do, it's going to be a problem, so let's go ahead and take care of it. We can do that by simply adding a host specifier. In my case, I'll add host k3s.carpie.net. That will limit this rule to traffic coming in on that hostname only. With that fixed, now we'll have to deploy it again, but we'll do that in a bit. Let's copy the config and then paste it into our registry config file. Change the name to docker-registry-ingress. Still using traffic for ingress. We're still using Let's Encrypt Prod as our issuer. We'll change the host to docker.carpie.net so that traffic will route the incoming traffic based on the host name that we request. I don't think we need path, so delete that. We'll route to the docker-registry-service. That's on port 5000. For our certificate request, the host is docker.carpie.net. We'll say that we want that to be stored in a secret named docker-carpie-net-tls. So we save the file and the configuration is complete. Before we move on, in case it wasn't clear before, let's look at that routing problem I mentioned with the previous MySite deployment. If we take a look at our ingress records, you can see the ingress for MySite is set to get traffic from all hosts. We're about to create a second host, docker.carpie.net, in my case. But it'll never receive traffic since the my side ingress is gobbling up all traffic to all hosts. Now let's deploy the fix we made. Again, if you don't have this scenario, you don't need to do it. We just apply our fixed my site config. Now if we look at the ingress records again, you can see that my site will now only get traffic destined for k3s.carpie.net. We have one more thing to do before doing the deploy. Since we're requesting a public TLS certificate, remember we need the requested domain name to route to our cluster. In my case, I've gone back to Cloudflare and I've added an A record for docker.carpie.net. Obviously, you'll need to add such a record for whatever domain that you're using. But let's give that name a quick check to make sure it's working. Again, we can do this with the dig command. If you don't get an IP address back here, either yours or your DNS server's proxy address, then something is wrong. You need to figure this out before you move on. In this case, all is well, so let's proceed. If you made it this far in the K3S series, the deploy command should be routine to you. Just a kubectl apply-f on the registry YAML file. Let's give that a bit to spin up. Check it with kubectl getpods, and it looks good. So let's check our certificate. There's our new certificate, and ready is true, so we're good to go. Okay, let's try this out. The first thing we need to do is have Docker on our development machine. If you're running on Ubuntu or a derivative, you can install docker.io with apt, and that's what I'll do here. If you're not, or you just want the latest and greatest, I provided a link to the Docker installation instructions in the video description. If you want to add your local computer user to the Docker group, at least on Linux, you can do that with add user. Sadly, getting added to a group requires a logout and backend to take effect, so please do that if you need to. Due to the magic of editing, you don't have to wait for me to do the same. Docker installed, let's pull the ARM32v7 version of our old friend Nginx from Docker Hub to our local Docker cache. I'm pulling the ARM32v7 specifically because that's what the Pi needs, and ultimately this is going to go to the Pi. If I just pulled Nginx, I get the AMD 64 version since that's what my PC is. We can check our local cache with Docker images, and there it is. So far, so good. Now, when pushing images to a registry, Docker uses the leading part of the image name as the destination. Since my registry is docker-carpie.net, I need to name the image with that name as a prefix, get it to go where I want it. So we can do that with docker tag. We've tagged the latest version of our local ARM32v7 Nginx as docker.carpie.net/ARM32v7/Nginx. And when we push that tagged image, Docker reads that first bit and knows to deliver it to docker.carpie.net as our registry. But let's try a push. We really expect it to fail right now because we've set up authentication, but we haven't done any sort of login. So let's make sure that is working. There we go. We get back no basic auth credentials. Good. Our basic auth is preventing anonymous pushes. So now we can log in with Docker login. Remember, we specified registry as our username, and we'll use the password we chose when we set up our credentials as the password. Okay, login succeeded. Let's try the push again. It looks like it worked, but let's make sure. We have both images in our local Docker cache, but let's delete both. Now with our cache clear, let's pull that image back from our registry. And there it is, it's working. So at some point, if you're like me, you'll forget what's in your registry. Sadly, there's no Docker command line way to query a registry to determine what's in it. We can use the Docker API, however. Here's how that would look using curl. We just use curl with some basic auth options to log in and access a Docker registry API. For readability, we pop the output through the Python JSON tool to pretty print the result. So there we go. Congratulations on a working Docker registry. In the next video, we're going to learn how to populate that registry with our own custom images. We have some hoops to jump through to create those custom ARM images on our AMD 64 PC, but nothing we can't handle. That's all for this video. Thanks for watching.
If you like this video and would like to see more, please consider subscribing to my channel.